Good morning, everyone, and welcome to Connect Church Online. I am so grateful that you've decided to join us for worship today. As always, our community is blessed by your presence, and so we are thankful that you are here with us. Got a couple of announcements for you. As always, while I do that, I would encourage you to say hello in the comments section of our online worship platform. It's always a blessing for us who are here in person to know you're out there in virtual land worshiping with us, and so we hope you'll say hello so that we can hear from you. Got the announcements for you. So today's Palm Sunday, as you know, which means that this next week is Holy Week. So that means that on Friday, we will be having our Good Friday service here at the church at 7 p.m. Good Friday is an opportunity to come and to remember, recognize the power of the crucifixion. And so I invite you to come and do that with us on Friday night at 7. And then Sunday is Easter. Obviously, we celebrate the day of the resurrection. We have our Easter egg hunt for the kiddos right after church. And so we hope you'll come and join us for that. Over the next few weeks, we are also going to be putting together pictures for our directory. And so if you would like to be included in the directory, we encourage you to do that. If you worship with was this online and you can't make it by in person, if you'd like to send us a picture to info@connectumc.org, we'll get those upgraded in our internal records and also include you in the directory. Also coming up after Easter, we have a couple of women's and men's event. Well, one men's event and women's event, two events. One for the men, one for the women. They are going to be going to Urban Tomahawk, which is just an axe throwing thing. It's super fun. It's going to be an opportunity for folks to celebrate and enjoy one another and spend time together. And so we hope that you will come and join us for that. The information for that is available on your screen. And you can also check that out in the newsletter. Other than that, I'm just glad you're here. And I'd like to invite you to join me now in saying the things that unite us here as a church family. So here we go. Here at Connect Church, our mission is to connect to God and connect to others. And our vision is to share the transforming power of Christ by creating a community set on making a difference in the world by living out Christ's three greats, the great commandment, to love the Lord your God with all your heart, with all your soul, with all your mind, and with all your strength, the commandment of great compassion. Truly I tell you, whatever you did for one of the least of these brothers and sisters of mine, you did for me. And the Great Commission, go and make disciples of all nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father and the Son and the Holy Spirit, teaching them to obey everything I have commanded you. And while these are the things that unite us here at Connect Church, we are also united with Christians around the world. And so each week we join their voices in saying the Apostles' Creed together. I believe in God, the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified and dead and buried. The third day he rose from the dead, he ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of God the Father Almighty. From thence he shall come to judge the quick and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Now, if you will join me in prayer. Lord God, we thank you so much for being who you are. We ask that you send your Spirit into this place, that you would inspire us and transform us, allow us to worship you today. In your holy and wonderful name we pray. Amen. Good morning, everyone, and welcome to Connect Church. I'm so glad you are here and worshiping with us. It's always a blessing to our community to know that you're present. And so if you're worshiping with us online, we're so grateful for you to be here with us as well. So today is two things. Today is the conclusion of our sermon series that we've been working on through the season of Lent. It's called Difference Maker, and it is based on the idea that in order to make a difference, we have to be different. It is also Palm Sunday, which I think is a very, if you didn't grow up in church and you didn't see the ceremonies and traditions that we have around Palm Sunday, and you just kind of wandered into a church on a random Sunday, and it turned out to be Palm Sunday, and you saw all the Christians waving palm branches and saying Hosanna in the highest and all of those kinds of things, you would think to yourself, and rightfully so, this is weird. This is a weird thing. And the good news for you is that it is a weird thing, and it was a weird thing back in the days of Jesus. The Palm Sunday procession where Jesus comes into Jerusalem on a donkey and they wave palm branches in the air, all of that was strange, okay? And so what we're going to talk about today is how Jesus lived differently, how he did different kinds of things, especially things like on Palm Sunday, that everyone noticed. And they realized that since Jesus was living differently, he had a different sort of message. And because he had a different sort of message and lived so differently, it made a difference in the world. And so since that's our sermon series that we've been working on the past few weeks, it's very fitting that we conclude it today as we talk about Palm Sunday. So to really understand Palm Sunday, you have to understand a little bit of historical context. So back in the day when Jesus was walking around on earth, there was the Romans ruled a huge chunk of the world, and they ruled, included in their empire was Jerusalem. And so Roman traditions and Roman practices were very prevalent in Israel and in all over parts of the known world. And so when Roman tradition was very powerful and often practiced, everyone kind of knew about it and knew what it was. This was the world they lived in, right? So one of the things that they really liked to do was parades. They would have big military parades especially. And these military parades were often done to celebrate a general or a politician. Military conquest and political power were very tied together. And so when a general or a leader had a significant military victory that they were a part of or that they funded, when they had that victory, they would oftentimes come back to a major capital city, the biggest being Rome, and they would have these huge parades through the streets of Rome. Sometimes these parades would last for days on end to have everyone celebrate and say, wow, look at this general or this politician, look how powerful and successful and awesome they are that they went out and had this conquest. And they would scatter expensive like plants, flora onto the ground. They would, different kinds of flowers usually and roses. They would scatter them onto the ground so that the general or the other politicians could walk through the streets on these flowers and people would chant their name. It was this big, huge thing, right? So when a general went away to war and would come back, they had these huge parades. Now, Jerusalem is the capital city of Israel, just as Rome is the capital of the Roman Empire. And Jesus is supposed to be the king of God's kingdom and of Israel, just as Rome is supposed to be, or the Caesar is supposed to be the ruler of Rome. And so what we get is this really interesting image where we are comparing parades, right? We have this huge parade in Rome where there's rose petals and expensive food given away and all of that. And then we have this other parade that happens in Israel that's referred to in John chapter 12. And this is what the story is described as. It says, "The next day, the great crowd that had come for the festival heard that Jesus was on his way to Jerusalem. So they took palm branches and they went out to meet him, shouting, 'Hosanna! Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. Blessed is the King of Israel.' Jesus found a young donkey and sat on it, as it is written, 'Do not be afraid, daughter Zion. See, your king is coming, seated on a donkey's colt.'" And so we get this description that Jesus is coming into the streets of Jerusalem. Instead of rose petals, there's there's palm branches, which are just growing all over the place, so they're free and easy to get. Instead of sitting on a powerful war horse, right, or chariot, he's sitting on a donkey that he borrowed, right? And so it's this interesting contrast between what a conquering ruler or conquering general looks like and what Jesus looked like. Now, if you're a person who lives in Israel, and I promise we're going to get to the sermon. This is all a little bit of historical context to help. If you're a Jewish person who lives in Israel, you expect that someday God is going to send you a Messiah. And this Messiah, when he shows up, is going to raise an army, right, of Israelite people. They are going to rebel against the Romans. They're gonna push the Romans out of their home, and they are going to have self-governance again. And so they are expecting the Messiah to show up to be a military leader, to be someone who says, hey, come and follow me. I'm going to lead us in kicking out the Romans and establishing our own government that honors God again. And so if you are a person, a Jewish person during in Israel at that time, you could ask anybody, what is the Messiah going to do? The expectation is the Messiah is going to raise up an army, kick out the Romans, rebuild all of our stuff that we used to have, and we're going to rule again just as God promised, right? And then this Jesus guy shows up, and he doesn't sound exactly the way that the Messiah is supposed to sound. He's not talking about rebelling against the Romans. He's not talking about a lot of the things that they expected him to talk about. He's talking about hope and love and peace and charity, and this message is resonating. And more people are starting to gather, and a lot of people are asking themselves, is this Jesus, is this the Messiah, is this the guy? Is this the one that's going to, if we follow him, he's going to raise up the army, he's going to kick out the Romans, and this is what it's going to look like. And so the expectation is in the air. Even the Romans they've heard about this, they're afraid that there's going to be some guy, Jesus, who puts together a large group of people and everybody decides to follow him, and they're going to raise up the army, and then the Romans have to deal with this whole revolt thing, and they don't want to do that. They just want to, you know, have people pay their taxes. They don't want to mess with all the revolts and all those kinds of things. And so they see all of this happening, right? And then Jesus shows up in Jerusalem, which is the capital city, and this parade happens. And the weirdest thing is, it's not like the traditional military parade that the Romans are used to seeing. There's no powerful war horse. There's no free food. There's no rose petals. There's palm branches and a borrowed donkey. And Jesus comes into Jerusalem, and people are shouting, Hosanna in the highest. Now, as you and I know, Jesus is the Messiah. But we also know that Jesus is not the Messiah that was expected. And I think some of the people there that day realized, wait a minute, there's no swords, there's no army, this isn't what we thought it was going to be. This is different. And so today, that's what we're going to talk about. We're going to talk about how Jesus is often different than we expect. And because Jesus is different than we expect, it makes a difference. So that brings us to our very first thing that we're going to talk about today, and that is that Jesus is different from the king we expected. Jesus does not always do the things that we expect or think Jesus should do. We oftentimes have expectations, and many times we have instructions for God. Jesus, this is the thing that I need you to do. This is where I need you to go. This is what I need you to say. This is the prayers that I need you to answer. This is how you're going to answer those prayers. This is what we expect of Jesus. Now, the problem with that is, Jesus doesn't answer to you and to me. And no matter how many times I tell Jesus what Jesus needs to do and how Jesus needs to do it, Jesus oftentimes does his own thing. All the time. Does his own thing. But it's not because Jesus doesn't care about me. It's because Jesus knows better. It's because the things that Jesus does are the right things, but oftentimes those right things are not the things that I expect. In order to understand this concept, we're going to turn to a great theologian. I don't know how good of a theologian he is, but he wrote a song, a guy named Garth Brooks. He wrote a song that I think describes this concept really well. You're probably familiar with it. It was a really popular song years ago. So this is how the song goes. Just the other night at a hometown football game, my wife and I ran into my old high school flame. And as I introduced them, the past came back to me, and I couldn't help but think of the way things used to be. She was the one that I'd wanted for all time, and each night I'd spend praying that God would make her mine. And if he'd grant me this wish I wished back then I'd never ask for anything again. Sometimes I thank God for unanswered prayers. Remember when you're talking to the man upstairs, and just because he doesn't answer doesn't mean he don't care. Because some of God's greatest gifts are unanswered prayers. So what Garth Brooks is describing is that he is happily married to the love of his life. But at one point in his life, when he was in high school, he wanted someone else, right? And he prayed and prayed and prayed and hoped and hoped and hoped and asked God, said, God, please do this thing for me. Make this a possibility. And God said no. Because God knew that he had someone else in store for Garth Brooks, right? Someone else in store for him, okay? And oftentimes, and it's a lovely romantic song, but it's also good theology. Because oftentimes, we pray or ask God to do things that are not as good as the things that God plans to do for us, or through us, or with us. And many times we get frustrated with God and we say, Jesus, why aren't you doing this thing that I expect you to do? And we sometimes say, you have abandoned me. I feel hopeless. I feel lost. You're not doing the things that I want you to do. And we get frustrated with Jesus, right, for not being who we called him, who we expect him to be. This is what many of the Jews on Palm Sunday must have felt like. Why isn't he showing up with an army and a sword and this whole thing? There's a donkey that he borrowed and palm branches. Where's the army? Where's the rebellion? Where's the kicking out of the Romans? Like, why isn't this happening? Because Jesus had a better plan. He was going to establish a kingdom, but it was going to be a heavenly kingdom. He was going to save you and me, but it was going to be a different way. And oftentimes you and I decide what God should do. And when we decide what God should do, oftentimes we find ourselves frustrated and angry. And we even feel abandoned by God, not because God is not doing the right thing, but because God isn't meeting the expectations that we've laid upon him. And so what we have to do is be more aware of the ways in which we are viewing God's work. We have to realize that just because God isn't doing what we expect God to do doesn't mean that God isn't doing the right thing, the good thing. And we have to make sure that we create room in our own prayers, our own spiritual walk, and our own minds for God to do the things that God needs to do during the time that God needs to do them, instead of you and me getting frustrated with God for not doing what I want God to do. Jesus is different because he cares about the right thing more than the popular thing. Jesus is different because he cares about doing the right thing for you more than he cares about doing the thing you want. And that makes Jesus different. Jesus is also different because his power and strength come from love instead of conquest. As I said, the people of Jesus' day expected him to raise the army and to beat the Romans, right? Kill people, drive them out, to have a victory, a military victory, a conquest of violence. This is what people expected the Messiah to do. But that's not who Jesus was. It's not what God's all about, right? 1 John 4 says, anyone who does not love does not know God, because God is love. Jesus absolutely had a victory over sin and death, but it wasn't done through putting others down or conquering them or defeating them. It was done through love. It was done through truth and generosity. He defeated the enemy by letting them know that God loved them and helped them be successful instead of trying to destroy them. Sometimes marriages fall apart, as you all know. And there are many reasons for that. But one of the reasons that marriages fall apart sometimes is because the two people, they get to a place where they're trying to win, not work together, right? That an argument becomes someone wins and someone loses. instead of a disagreement becoming an opportunity for these two people to love one another and work together to solve a problem. And when one spouse begins to talk in the range of, I'm right about this one, I'm winning this argument, or I'm losing this argument, when a spouse begins to talk and think that way, you might win an argument, but you might lose your family. And the same thing works in a larger scale, right? I happen to be of the opinion that Democrats and Republicans don't need to defeat one another in order for our country to be healthy. I'm of the opinion that destroying the people of the other political party, destroying political opponents, conquering political opponents, winning debates, those sorts of things, I don't think that stuff makes the country better. I think it's through love and hope and moving together for a common goal of goodness for all people that good things happen. Jesus was different because his victory did not come by destroying others, but by lifting them up. And that brings me to my next point, which is that Jesus is different because he is the king of humility instead of pride. I kind of described to you the Roman parade already, but the point of the Roman parades were very political and motivated, right? They were trying to gain prestige and power and recognition and support. The Roman elite were oftentimes trying to get the regular citizens to support their movement and see them as wealthy and powerful and exalted. The parades were about trying to make sure that they were lifted up, right? And then Jesus comes along and he says the kingdom is going to be different. He describes the kingdom the way that Paul describes it in Philippians. He says, do nothing out of selfish ambition or vain conceit. Rather, in humility, value others above yourself. It's not about who can do the best job of building themselves up. It's about who can do the best job of building up those around you. My success is not about how much power or wealth or authority or respect or whatever it else is that I'm trying to gain. It's not about how much I can get. It's about how much I can use the things that God has given me to help the people around me be successful. This is what Jesus says. If I can be generous in a sacrificial way, can I think about others more highly than myself? Can I lift up God's kingdom over my own agenda? That's the things that Jesus taught. And that's what made Jesus different. Let's go back to the political thing for just a minute. When we do finally elect a president, which hopefully we get to without too much animosity in our country, but when we finally do elect a president, our hope, I think everyone's hope, would be that whoever ends up in the office is not going to make decisions based on what's the best thing for them, right? They're not going to say, I am now going to make an executive order because this is going to work out well for me, right? And I don't care how it affects anybody else. I'm going to do the thing that's going to be best for me. We don't want that in a president, right? We want the president to say, my number one priority is to make decisions that are better for the people, right? As a whole, not for just what's better for me, but better for the people. That's my responsibility as the president. I'm not the president, but you know what I mean. As the president, we want the president to say, it's my responsibility to make decisions for the people and what's best for them, not for what's best for me. We expect a mayor to make decisions based on what's good for the town, not what's best for them. Or you can even think about a family. If you're a member of a family, whatever your role is in that family, the moment that any of us start to make decisions about what's best for me, regardless of how that affects anybody else around me, I'm going to do what's best for me, even if it hurts the people around me. That's how families are destroyed. That's how marriages are destroyed. And that's why Jesus is different. Because Jesus teaches us not just to exalt ourselves or do what's best, but to be constantly asking ourselves, what's good for me and the people around me? How can I use the things that God has given me to serve my family and my church and my community? my loved ones and my enemies? How can I use the things that God has given to me to make the world a better place for the people that God loves? That's different. The Roman parades was about how much can I get for me? In much of the world today, it's about how much can I get for me so that I can be on top of the pile. What Jesus said is, do nothing out of selfishness or vain conceit, but to think about others more highly than yourself. And so that's different, and it's powerful. Jesus is also different because he loves freely but holds us accountable without hesitation. When Jesus came walking into Jerusalem, and he, you know, they had the parade and the palm leaves and the borrowed donkey and the whole thing, where he went was the temple. He walked through town, and he walked up the hill, and he went to the temple. And when he got to the temple, what he found was people selling animals and those sort of things to be sacrificed in the temple. And it was a whole complicated thing, but essentially there was people who were taking financial advantage of others who were just trying to have a connection with God, right? And Jesus sees people trying to take financial advantage of others who are trying to have a connection with God, and Jesus doesn't like that. So he starts flipping over tables, right, and fashions the whip, and he's chasing people out of the thing, because Jesus certainly loves all people, but Jesus also, when he sees sin, he holds people accountable. There's a story of a woman who came into a meal. Jesus was sharing a meal with some Pharisees, and this woman came in, and she was a sinner. She'd done a lot of things that she shouldn't have done, and she was crying, and she's wiping Jesus' feet, and Jesus looks at her, and he says that your sins are forgiven, and then he says this, but go and sin no more. Don't do that anymore. Jesus hung out with sinners and tax collectors, not just the religious folks. And it is true that when Jesus was hanging out with sinners and tax collectors, a lot of the religious folks didn't like it. But it's also true that Jesus would never tell a sinner or a tax collector or a religious person that their sins were okay. He would say, I love you. I forgive you. I want to help you be successful. But when you do things wrong, it's not okay. I think oftentimes, as regular people, we either want to love and affirm people, or we want to condemn. And Jesus was different because he both loved and affirmed people, but also held them accountable to when their actions didn't align with what was in the best interest for their healthy lives. And this made Jesus different. And this is the expectation that Jesus had for his Christians today, that we love all people while simultaneously calling out sin in the world when we see it. Jesus was different because he would love and hold accountable at the same time. Jesus was also different because he prioritized pleasing God over people. The reason that Jesus was not like anyone else, I mean, when it really comes down to it, the reason that Jesus was not like anyone else, the reason that Jesus was different was because he was set on meeting God's expectations. Not people's expectations of what he should or shouldn't do or should or shouldn't say. What Jesus cared about only was pleasing God. This is from Romans 12. It says, do not be conformed to this world, but be transformed by the renewal of your mind, that by testing you may discern what is the will of God, what is good and acceptable and perfect. You don't have to be what other people expect you to be. But you are called to be what God expects you to be. Jesus understood this. And because Jesus' priority wasn't pleasing the people around him, because Jesus' priority was serving God and meeting God's expectations, he lived differently. And if we can choose this different sort of path as well, if we can choose to have the courage that despite what other people say or think about us, we choose to do the things that God says we should do, to prioritize God's calling over our lives, to prioritize obedience to Christ as opposed to other things, if we could choose that, we'd be different as well. And when you choose to be different in this way, when you choose to follow God above everything else, when you make that choice to be that kind of different, you'll make a difference. You'll make a difference in your family. You'll make a difference in the hearts and the minds of your church community. You make a difference in your workplace. You make a difference in the world. When you choose to be about love, when you choose to be about Christ, you live different and you make a difference. In the name of the Father and the Son and the Holy Spirit, amen. Now we've reached the point in our worship where we have an opportunity to respond to whatever it is that God might be doing in our lives. In particular, in this moment, we will be responding through our giving. So if you consider Connect your home, we'd appreciate your gifts because it is through your giving that we are able to do all the ministries that we do here. So as you give, may you give with joy and generosity and hope for what God is doing in your life and in the future. If you're giving with us online, feel free to click on the giving link on the online worship platform and let that moment be a moment where you respond to the blessings that God has given to you and the ways in which God has touched your life. As you go from this place today, may you go in peace. May you know that no matter where you've fallen short, no matter what you've done, God loves you. God forgives you. So go in peace. In the name of the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Amen.